What's going on, Salt Strong Nation? We are back with another awesome podcast episode. I've got a very highly requested guest here, Captain Caleb McCumber. He came on to give a little bit of an update about the fish kill here in Texas. We've got some tutorials in the works with him, and you guys have asked for some more content with Caleb. So we wanted to bring him on to talk about redfish and also kind of share some of his story, but we're going to be talking a lot about redfish today, seasonal trends, different tactics you're going to want to use. And we're going to be going into some stuff that you'll probably be using here within the next couple months for redfish as we get into the heat of summer. But welcome, Captain Caleb. We're very excited to have you on the podcast today, man.
Man, you're making me blush, Wyatt. I'm happy to be here. It only took us, what, 90 days to get this figured out?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no. For those of you who don't know, I moved here to Texas just a couple of months ago. Captain Caleb was one of the first guides to reach out to me and just kind of welcome me to the area and kind of start showing me around. So very excited to finally get him on. We've been trying to get him on for a little while here. But yeah, man, we're super excited to have you on today.
No, it's awesome. I've been, you know, paying attention to Salt Strong for a while now. And then whenever you moved down here, some of your friends from on the East Coast called me and said, hey, you need to get to know Wyatt and do some stuff with him. And when those guys said, hey, let's make it happen, then I was all about it. So I really appreciate the invite. And I appreciate being able to share some of my insights here on the Texas Gulf Coast.
Absolutely, man. I'd like to kind of start diving into that. So you are a co-host on one of the biggest fishing podcasts out there, and probably definitely the biggest podcast here in Texas, the Bite Me podcast. And you also have your own YouTube channel, tons of really great tutorials on there. And you are a full-time guide. So you do a lot of teaching, a lot of really good education for anglers out there. And I kind of wanted to ask you before we get into, you know, the tactics and the stuff that most people are tuning into, I want people to know you a little bit more. So what got you into guiding and teaching and, you know, being a co-host on a huge podcast? What got you into wanting to help people become better fishermen?
Well, you know, it all kind of step by step and happened on accident. I started guiding whenever I was a little bitty kid. I grew up on a big ranch in South Texas, not far from where you live now. And my dad had a big hunting operation, quail, dove, and deer. And whenever I was 12 years old, I was already, you know, running one of our Jeeps and the English pointers and whatnot. And at that time, I was doing a lot of fishing. We had several tanks there on the ranch. And then I grew up next to Choke Canyon. Then down the road was Falcon and Amistad. So I grew up doing a lot of freshwater fishing, and then that translated into saltwater stuff. I ended up dating a girl, and her grandfather was really big into that, and so that got me into it even more. And whenever I came to college, that's whenever I came over here to the Matagorda area. My roommate lived; he had a house right on the Colorado River there in Matagorda, and I went and doing a lot of stuff with that. And I had at that time I was working an office job, or you know, right after college I was working an office job, and I wanted to just, you know, do my job. And then when I was 50 or 60, start guiding, and you know, life doesn't always cooperate. So I ended up, you know, fishing more and more and more, got into tournaments, and then I got my captain's license and started doing that. And back then it was just the, you know, every guide out there, you know, I'd have four or five people on the weekend with some popping corks and some shrimp. And after a couple of years of that, I got to where I honestly dreaded my job because it wasn't me. It didn't fulfill me as much as whenever I was doing the hunting stuff down south. And that's whenever I went into the, you know, hey, I'm doing lures only. I'm doing CPR only. Well, and through all of that is whenever I started meeting different people in the industry. And as I matured as a guide and matured the teaching stuff, that's whenever I got the call to do the Bite Me podcast. And I think we get about 35,000 downloads either a month or an episode. I can't remember. But, you know, we do that once a week. I'm going to record that tomorrow. And from the Bite Me, man, whenever I started Bite Me, I was so nervous. I thought I was going to throw up the first time John asked me a question. But as I got more and more comfortable with it, I realized that I really enjoyed doing it. And it got to the point where Scott and John were getting calls. Hey, we want Captain Caleb back on. And so I kept coming back, and now I'm on there quite often. And that gave me the springboard to go into YouTube, where I knew if I started a channel that, you know, it would take off, you know, a little faster than most of the guys that have to grow completely organically. And so, about a little over a year ago, I got into the YouTube, and I think we're pushing about 10,000 subscribers now. I think there's, I don't know, 60 videos out. But it's just something I never knew I had it in me to you know, be the guy that got behind the microphone or behind the camera. Because whenever I was in the corporate world, I was asked to be on stage a lot, and I absolutely hated it. But I also didn't like talking about oil and gas. I like talking about fishing. I like meeting people. I like helping people, you know. And to be honest with you, even the most beginner fishermen, talking to them, I actually pick up stuff from them too. I've been out on my boat many times when a guy that's brand new to it just completely whoops me for the day because he's doing something really elementary that you know, maybe I did a long time ago, but now I'm trying to be too complicated or, you know, and when I simplify it back down. So I'm learning just as much from those people as they are from me.
Yeah, no, and that's really the cool thing is the teaching aspect. As you continue to teach people, it's really interesting how much you get back from it. A really good example is this. Is I actually found you through one of those YouTube tutorials. I was trying to learn how to use one of the famous Texas baits out there, the Corkies. And I think that might be one of the big videos on your channel. If you guys haven't seen that tutorial on how to fish a Corky from Captain Caleb, phenomenal. I mean, it was super simple the way that he taught it, but it just gives you everything you need to know. Just good examples, things like that. But there was so much discussion in the comments section. And that's what we also love about the insider community is it's all just based around sharing information, guys that are veterans, guys that are amateurs, guys that are just getting into it. You know, there's a great discussion that can go on just between all different skill levels of anglers. And it's really cool to see that you guys are building that community with the Bite Me podcast and that you're starting to build that with your channel as well. But I do want to start getting into some teaching stuff here. I think probably the first thing that we get a lot of questions on that I thought would be really good to have you discuss, because as you said, you've been in this game for a long time. You've been around saltwater fishing for a while now. One of the biggest things we get is, you know, what are seasonal bait migrations? What types of baits are going to be most active at different times of year, especially, you know, here in Texas, where we've got, you know, big shad hatches, we've got Gulf shrimp that are pouring out of the marshes, things like that. And most people don't actually know when those things take place. And I think a lot of that plays into what tackle you're going to throw, the types of areas you're going to target, knowing where that bait is and what bait is most prevalent at times of year can really play into how successful you're going to be on the water. So as someone that's been here for a while, someone that's been in the game for a while, would you mind giving us a rundown of the seasonal bait migrations throughout the year? We'll probably start with fall and then we'll end with summer because that's what we're about to get into. And then we'll do a little bit more of a discussion on tactics there as well. So as far as redfish go, what types of bait are they kind of keying in on at different times of the year? Like I said, we'll probably start with fall here and then we'll move on through the summer.
So everybody has different types of fishing patterns. I'll go through, you know, what I like to do. Whenever if you get into the deep water, like Galveston or whatnot, the rules, they change up. They're a little bit different. But we'll focus more on the bays that are, you know, kind of like what we're at, 6 to 12 feet with the back marshes and all that kind of stuff. And the fall is my favorite time of year to fish. You're getting a lot of the bait hatches of small shrimp. You know, there's smaller bait out there. And that's why you'll see a lot of the posts on social media about, you know, the birds working in certain bays and whatnot. So what's happening there is you're in the fall, you're coming off of your big summer tides. So this tide's still up pretty high and back in the marshes, back in the grasses, the small shrimp, the small juvenile fish, they're hatching and growing a bit back there in the grass. Well, what I tell everybody, November is a really popular time for people to book with me because that's whenever I can, you know, when they have the wife or the kids, they want to go. Being as how I am a lure guy, I tell a lot of people, hey, if you really want to have a high percentage chance of a good day, you need to book with me after two solid cold fronts. And that's typically the end of October, November. Now, the reason I'm saying that is not necessarily water temperature, air temperature. But those first couple of cold fronts that come through here often have a strong northwest wind to them. And our area of the bay, which I'm referencing basically Sabine to Corpus, that northwest wind will dump our tides. And what that does is all of the bait and all of the little munchies out in the grass, they get sucked out into the bays. Well, when they get sucked out into the bays, that then the water temperature and stuff starts coming into play because that triggers those small baits to, you know, instinctually start migrating into the Gulf. And so they're going to start going across those bays. Well, when they do, that's whenever the redfish and the trout and whatnot, they start seeing all these little bait. They start hitting them. That wads the bait up in balls. That ends up getting a bunch of fish under them. Well, when that bait's wadded up in balls, when the fish are hitting them, they're popping out of the water and the birds are on top of them grabbing them. So it makes it very easy for us as fishermen to see a group of seagulls working and move to them. So that's one of the most beautiful things about the fall. And the same thing is happening in the marshes as well. And, you know, in our marshes here in Texas, there's more redfish than there are trout. So then you're getting the, you know, the birds working on the redfish there in the marsh, or maybe there's no birds at all, but you can see the wakes from the fish. You can see the shrimp popping here and there. So the fall is a pretty easy time to fish. Even if it's too windy to see the fish pushing, or it's too windy to keep the birds off the water, you still can remember that you have bait coming out of the marshes, out of the flats, and target an outgoing tide, especially where that bait's being drained out. And quite often there's going to be fish stacked up there in front of it.
Yeah, so that's a really good description of fall. You know, there's a lot of bait still around. It's all dumping out. You know, getting into winter, though, this is one of those times where it seems like a lot of that bait's moved out. It's kind of almost scarce to find it. And one of my big things, you know, any kind of bait activity, any mullet jumping, shrimp popping, if they're there, you know, that is going to indicate to me that's an area that's probably going to be game fish. As far as the types of forage that are going to be available in the wintertime, do you find it's more bait fish prevalent? Is it more crustacean prevalent with crabs or shrimp? What do you find redfish keying in on a little bit more in the wintertime?
So once the fall's over and the smaller bait fish and the shrimp have all migrated out, then yeah, that, you know, your January through February, you know, maybe even the end of December, just depending on when winter really shows up, which is always a guess here in Texas, right? But yeah, then you're going to move on to your bigger bait fish, your bigger mullet and whatnot. So we're in the fall, you're looking for a bunch of bait. In the wintertime, you can often be looking for, you know, just a little bit of bait, and you're going to have to be more patient with what's going on. I love to fish the marshes in the dead of the winter. I'm not back there much. The water's cold. The fish have moved out of that shallow water. They're into deeper water. So if I'm redfishing, I'm looking more at intercoastals or deeper cuts or deeper bays. One thing I really key on in the wintertime, I do a lot more wading then. I used to wade all the time. I'm getting older now, man. My back hurts. My neck hurts. But in the wintertime is whenever it's easier to get me out of the boat. And the reason being is in the winter, I'll really key on warming trends. We see so often people say, oh man, you know, the cold front's here, we should be out fishing right now. And while I understand fishing before the front, you know, you get that little barometer dip and the fish, they can often go off. It's a bit of a misconception that the day that front's there or the day after, that when it's cold and nasty, we should be out there. Because, and most of the time you shouldn't. 2 days after a front is notoriously tough for any kind of fishing. The barometer's just not there. But what I really key on is that third and fourth day, often when those clouds blow out and it gets sunny again, then that's whenever those fish will move up on the flat to warm up. That's when the bait will move up on the flat to warm up. So that's whenever I'm really going to be out and looking for those, you know, medium-sized mullet flipping around when there's a warming trend, warming up a flat, maybe, you know, 2, 3, 4 feet of water, even less in a lot of areas. But that's whenever finding just a couple of mid-sized bait flipping around becomes really important. Crustaceans, you just don't see much of that in the wintertime.
That is a pretty good assessment of winter. You know, we do get a lot of larger bait fish, it seems like, here in Texas. It's funny, when I lived over on the East Coast, it seemed like there were a lot of crustaceans, you know, lots of crabs that would show up in the wintertime. So it's really interesting to see the difference between, you know, a little bit more of a crustacean focused wintertime tackle selection, as we're trying to match those baits that those fish are on. Moving here to Texas, it seems like there are that medium to almost large size bait fish that's a little bit more prevalent as they are in the marsh. And again, I completely agree with you. Any kind of warming trend that we can get in the wintertime is super important to target, to spend a little bit of time up there while the bait is active and those fish are getting active. Again, as they are cold-blooded, that temperature is going to affect their metabolism. If it warms up, that metabolism fires up and they're going to go look for somewhere they can feed. Just because in wintertime, they don't get a whole lot of opportunities like that. That temperature, when it does get cold, seems to lock them down a lot. But, you know, once we do get over those cold temperatures of winter, thankfully, we were able to move out of that crazy freeze we just had. And now we've gotten into some really good spring fishing. And I'd like you to kind of evaluate some of the different types of bait patterns, again, that we're going to be seeing right now. And I mean, I've started to experience a lot of a lot of really good hot bites with all of the inflow and influx of bait that we've had. But I'd like you to expand on that a little bit more, what you see up in your area in terms of, you know, bait migrations, what types of bait fish are keying in on, and, you know, how that might affect some of the tackle that you're going to throw maybe right now, and maybe as we start to kind of get into summer as well.
So the springtime is probably one of my favorites right behind the fall. I don't know if the fishing is better than it is in the fall, but we've just endured a tough winter. And, you know, it's just I told somebody the other day that the spring hatches are the good Lord's way of saying, man, I'm real sorry about January and February and March. I know that was a grind, right? But no, now we're starting to see the really small glass minnows, the shad, the little bitty shrimp. Right now the redfish are going to be just about as heavy as they could possibly be. When you catch them, they're going to be gorged with a little, you know, a little tiny meat fish. But it starts out up in the creeks and whatnot. I had to get down on my knees in my boat and look at the water real hard a couple of weeks ago because it looked like, you know, big black balls of mosquito larvae in the water. And what that is the tiny shad. And, you know, as they get a little bit bigger, they're going to start migrating out into the bays, into the back lakes, you know, anything like that. Or even, well, we've had some big rain the last couple of days, you know, that fresh water will push them out too. And once that starts happening, that's whenever you start seeing your fish schooling up again. You start seeing, you know, the tides have come up. They're out of their winter swing. The tides are up in the bays. The water's, you know, there's a foot or two of water against the grass. That's when you're going to start seeing the sprays against the grass where flounder is sitting right on the grass and eating all of that stuff that's coming out of that. You'll see the redfish back up in the grass and the trout are cruising the grass. The trout are in front of cuts and drains and all kinds of whatnot. So this time of year, that's whenever I start going to my smaller, flashier lures. You know, for the folks that don't know, a shad, you know, he looks like a dime with fins and a nose, right? That's whenever I'll start going to the small mirror dines, the soft dines. I throw a lot of spinner baits this time of year. I throw a lot of little 3-inch paddle tails. I like anything flashy, anything small, even my topwaters. I use a lot of the Rapala topwaters or Rapala. I've never really figured it out. But you know, the little small Rapala topwaters. I like things small and flashy in the spring. I quit throwing the big stuff. In the wintertime, I'm throwing the quirky fat boys and, you know, and I will use a quirky year round and it will catch a fish year round. But for consistency right now, something small, something shiny, I'm probably near grass or a drain. If I'm in back lakes, I'm really keen on finding that big dark cloud of bait fish. You know, and I know we're going to talk about this later, but, you know, you get a lot of questions about fishing that dirty water in Texas. Well, bud, we can still see that. Those 3 million shad sitting there in the water. You see the little tiny ripples on the top or something like that. And that's what I'm really focusing in the spring.
Yeah, no, it's really interesting to see how much bait fish shows up in the spring. It's almost like there's too much. And those fish, like you said, they're going to be at their heaviest this time of year because there's so much for them to eat. You know, they're not fighting the cold temperatures of winter. They're not fighting the really hot temperatures of summer yet. It just seems like they're focused on feedings. And a tutorial that you put out recently about targeting the drains, I believe that, you know, regardless of where you live, these were tactics that I applied in the Carolinas where it was actually a little bit easier to target drains because we have bigger tidal swings in a marsh that, you know, is 2-3 feet in depth. You get a 5-foot swing, most of that marsh actually does dry up. And the drains, the areas that water is going to be flowing out of, and inflow outflow points in marshes or on flats are always really good zones to target. And you can usually spot these on satellite maps. You can see where the depth changes are. All the water on that flat usually is going to exit out through those areas. Yes, some of it may dump off on the sides that, you know, border the intercoastal channel or may border a large bay. But if you can find those, you know, dark cuts, when you look at them on satellite maps, if you're in an area that has clear water, they're going to show up as almost like dark blue. If you're targeting some of those dirtier marshes and you're looking at it on satellite maps, it almost looks blackish or dark brownish. But those cuts that lead out of the marshes, inflow, outflow points like that, those are those drains. And those are fantastic zones to target, as Captain Caleb just mentioned, because all these spring tides that have a little bit, you know, of a higher tide level that is going to push all that bait into the grass, that tide flow is going to be dropping out on those outgoing tides. And it's just an easy area for those fish to get on a ton of bait. And I think something else that was that was really good of you to point out was, you know, these are really, really small bait fish. I just put out a video recently on targeting Spanish mackerel, and they're on that same shad hatch that's, you know, dumping out of the inshore areas. They're sitting outside of those jetties, outside of those areas at the beach, and they're just getting onto all these shad. I actually called them snot bait, just because if you blow a snot rocket, it looks exactly like what that bait is. They are so small, so white. And I mean, it's tough to actually throw a lure if you're not throwing flies that are the size of that bait. But when you throw something small, like those miradines or those small little paddle tails that are really small, and really flashy, you know, like our slam shade, you know, just something small, silver or gold, something that's got some flash to it and is a tiny profile, you're not essentially mirroring one small bait fish. You're mirroring a small pod of them. Those predators like trout and red, they're not striking at individual bait fish. They're striking at small pods. So mirroring that kind of bait, the small bait fish, really seems to be key. And do you find that fish are still keyed in on any kind of crustacean profiles as we do? I know that there is a small outflow of shrimp to the Gulf right now that does occur in the springtime. Do you find that predators key in more on the shrimp or the bait fish?
You know, it's good that you brought that up. Daniel and I fished one of the professional Redfish League stops this weekend. It was a two-day tournament, and we found a point that had kind of an eddy coming around it. And every day between noon and two, the day that we found it and on day one of the tournament, it wouldn't be a lot going on there. But then as the tide changed, there would be just black clouds of the shad get up against these rocks to about probably 20 feet out. And it was a rather deep structure there, right? And the redfish were doing just what you're saying. They weren't targeting a fish. They were essentially opening their mouths and coming straight up out of the water, right? And so what we ended up doing was I threw a crankbait for a good amount of time. And my idea there was those fish were quite obviously staging below the shad and then coming up through them. So the reason I went with that crankbait was I wanted to get the lure down below the shad so that maybe while a fish was sitting there staging, waiting to go up on a group, I could swim that past him and get him caught. So on that particular day, that was the way that we got him caught. It wasn't necessarily mirroring the bait fish as it was just knowing there were fish in the area. And it wasn't hard to tell because I think there was 30 of them. We had them named coming full body out of the water, and it took us all day to catch five of them. And then another effective strategy that we used is we threw a wake bait through that shad. And what we were trying to do was to make something that looked like a group of fish for that fish to target. And that ended up catching some good fish as well. As far as shad versus shrimp, which is pretty well the two things we've got going on right now, if there's shad in the area, they seem to really be on shad. If they're shrimp, then we're seeing a totally different thing. When they're on the shad, you're seeing them blow up and whatnot. When they're on the shrimp, that's whenever you get the tailing fish. Their noses are down in the mud. They're rooting around. They're looking for these shrimp. They're swimming through grass. They're looking for the shrimp. And, you see shrimp popping everywhere. In that particular instance, I still don't really go to a crustacean imitation lure just because you don't really need to. What you do need to know is that when they are keying on shrimp, their noses are down, their eyes are down. I just had this question on my YouTube video a day or two ago. And you need to put that lure on the mud in front of them. If you swim it above a redfish's face, most of the time you're not going to catch that fish, whether they're schooling, whether they're tailing, any of that. A redfish just does not seem to want to look up and come up. If you can get it eye level or lower, that's when you can usually get to them, you know, in that regard.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. And it's very important that with redfish, your casting is down, especially like you said, when they are keyed in on crustaceans like that. You know, you really need to be able to put that in, you know, the dinner plate area. Essentially, you see those fish feeding, tails are up. You know, if you can see the tail is facing one way, you know which way the fish is feeding. You don't want to throw it behind it. This does take some practice as you get out on the water more. But yeah, I do believe in matching as fish, you know, are feeding on a specific bait profile. I try to match it, but I agree. It seems like if there are shad in the area, if there are bait fish, they tend to provide a little bit more of a high calorie meal for those predators. So it seems like reds will key in on more. bait fish if they are available. If I see shrimp popping, obviously I'm going to tie on, a small shrimp imitation, one of our power prawns, or I'll tie on a jerk shad. And jerk shads are a great in-between. If you're not sure and you are in an area that you know that there is redfish, I don't find that they're a fantastic search bait, but if you are throwing at reds, you don't know what they're keyed in on just yet, jerk shads can be great because you can work them in both a bait fish profile by, you know, twitching them a little bit faster. And you can also slow it down, double twitch pause to imitate, you know, a crustacean, a shrimp that may be fleeing. So I do like jerk shads in that respect. You know, Mirror Lure Little Johns are something I've been using. They've got that profile of both a shrimp and a small bait fish. So it can go either way with that, especially if you're using something that's got a little bit of flash to it. You know, those fish, they're going to see that bait fish or shrimp, whatever they're keyed in on, they're likely going to hit it. So
I'm really into matching the colors more so. I do, and the jerk bait is great where, you know, you can make it hop like a shrimp or kind of flow like a bait fish. But I really want the colors to be right. If there's a lot of shrimp, purple or pearl, that's what I throw a lot of. If there's a lot of shad, then obviously I'm throwing pearls or something shiny. For some reason, chartreuse seems to do well with that. I 100% believe that fish do not see the same color spectrum that we do. So I think that's why some of these wacky colors really work. But matching the colors and then putting the lure in the right spot. A lot of my guiding is sight casting off of my tower. And my number one phrase said on my boat is drop it, drop it, drop it. Because my customer will put the lure where it needs to be, but then be bringing it over a little bit too high. And drop it, drop it, drop it, and they'll quit reeling and it'll flutter down and wham. So that's dead on. I'm glad you brought that up.
No, yeah, it's funny because trout, you know, they have their eyes positioned on the top of their head. So they are typically looking for something that's swimming over them. That's why, you know, the top waters work great, burning paddle tails over potholes. It seems like you can swim things over trout and you'll get those reaction strikes. With reds, you know, a lot of times they are focused down. They're feeding down, their mouths are positioned and their jaw hinges downward. And they're usually, like you said, looking down. So you have to drop it 100%. That's a great way to put it. And most of my hits recently, as you know, I'm swimming my paddle tails in front of some of these fish, they all come on the drop, you know, a 4-count retrieve, 2-count drop. They're all hitting on that drop. If they do, you know, notice that something's in the area, when it gets down to their feeding level, it gets down to that, you know, strike zone for them, that's when you, a lot of times, will see those redfish hit. So I think that's something for anybody listening. We both now just discussed this in a little bit of a depth. Make sure you're getting it down to those fish. Drop it.
Drop it like it's hot.
Yeah, exactly. So I think this is a perfect segue into summertime now. I think we've hammered what's going on right now in the spring, and we want to get people prepared for what's about to happen in the summertime. Do we still see redfish keying in on some of these small bait fish? Are they moving up to some of the larger schools of mullet? You know, something I'm seeing right now, they are following around some of these larger mullet schools, but it doesn't seem like they are super keyed in on the large mullet. They're a lot of times keying in on the bait that's being scared up by the mullet schools, but it doesn't seem like they're actually targeting the mullet themselves. And at least in the Carolinas, it seemed like as we got into summertime, they would start to actually take swipes at some of those mullet schools, and some of my larger topwaters would start to pay off imitating some of those larger bait profiles. Do you see redfish here in Texas following that same pattern? And if they do, you know, what are you doing to kind of mirror that bait? Are you targeting different areas? Are you still following around the mullet schools? Or are they even keying in on a different bait profile? What do you see here happening in Texas in the summertime as far as bait profiles go?
No, in the summertime, it kind of becomes open game on bait. You know, if there's medium-sized mullet around, they're gonna get a, you know, shrimp. The shad are getting big by then. And in the summertime, I move away from the marshes quite as much. I mean, we're talking about the dog days of summer, whenever it's hot and the water's just getting stagnant and warm. You know, at that point, the oxygen levels start going down and the fish start coming out of that and into the deeper, cooler water. That's whenever I start to target stuff like surf fishing or, you know, rivers or, you know, deep stuff like that. And the shad that we're seeing now, by that point, they're bigger shad, but they become less keyed in on, you know, one particular thing in the summertime. In the summertime, I'm throwing, you know, your probably 4-inch paddle tails. I'll still throw my little 3-inch stuff. And then the full size skitter walks, the full size, you know, the one knockers and whatnot. And all that does pretty well. the bite can get slower on days in the summertime. So, you know, that's when the popping cork and the gulp comes out to try to, you know, entice them there. But, you know, you'll still have the shrimp and the shad and all that around. But like I said, they quit focusing on, you know, one little thing quite as much. In the summertime, one of the main keys for me is I'll tell my customers, hey, we have until about 11 o'clock to get this done because it's going to get hot. These fish are going to stop eating and they're going to feed again in the evening and in the night hours. So I'll be out in the early morning hours. I'll be out on, you know, shallow waters and whatnot. But when it starts getting real hot, that's when those fish will move to deeper water. So if you're going to keep fishing, then, you know, you move to your heavier baits and, you know, your bigger plastics, it's going to look like a mullet, you know, swimming around out there.
Yeah. I'd like you to expand on that a little bit more. So something that you covered, and this is something that we teach in the Insider Club a lot, is in the summer, DO2, which is dissolved oxygen. It seems like fish gravitate towards areas with higher DO2. And a lot of times you're not necessarily going to find them in the highest of DO2 areas, but they're going to stick by those zones. Cause just as Captain Caleb just said, around that 12 o'clock range, it gets hot enough to the point where those fish are not focused on feeding. They're going into preservation mode. So you're going to have deeper water nearby, which typically is going to have a thermocline. You're going to have some colder water in the deeper zones. It's not as easy to hunt in deeper water. If you think about predator fish, a lot of times they're trying to corner bait. They're trying to pin it up against the shoreline, or they're trying to pin it up against the surface of the water. And in deeper water, there's more area for that bait to flee. So when they get down into the deeper water in the later parts of the day, you may pick them up on your fish finder, things like that. Most times they're not necessarily feeding. They're down there to try and get their dissolved oxygen levels back to optimal zones. Redfish, you know, we know that they don't typically feed in current like trout do. They're going to be close to high current areas when they're feeding, but they don't like to sit in current. Their bodies aren't really designed to do that like trout are. A lot of times I will see them sticking close to passes and inlets where there's good cold current flow from the Gulf coming in, but they're not necessarily feeding in those areas. And like you said, in the early morning, late evening, they're moving to shallow zones where it's easier to hunt. It's easier to get onto that bait, but they are sticking close to zones with DO2. So I'd like you to expand a little bit further, if you want to, about some of the zones that you're going to target, the zones you're going to be taking your clients to in those early morning, late evening time zones in the summertime where you're seeing a lot of redfish activity.
Right. And so I'm a little bit different than a lot of guides in how I operate. Last year, I think I went 3 weeks without seeing another boat. And I think every day we were catching 30, 40, 50 fish. And I'll never forget it. My picture got put on Facebook, and I think the quote was "cats out of the bag," which I really appreciated that. But no, so what I'm going to do in the dog days of summer is I like the intercoastal. I like deep ditches. I like rivers. I like somewhere with deep water nearby. Now, the key that is for me and is that I like the tide when it's starting or ending. And just like you said, redfish don't like to get up there and work and paddle against a hard current. So the reason I like the start and the end is because the current is moving enough to wake them up and bring some bait to them and get them going. But it's not pushing so hard that they're burning more calories than they're taking in, right? So that's always the major key is, or even an eddy, you know. Like you said, they're not going to be in that current, but they're going to be close to it. And that's what Daniel and I were fishing this weekend. About 30 feet to our left, there were 3 foot rollers where the tide and the wind were working against each other. But we were in a little eddy where it wasn't as bad, but there was still movement. And that's just going to be super key all summer long, is find where they can go, you know, cool off and get their oxygen levels right, but where they can still come up and feed whenever they want to be there. In the summertime, you're going to find that sometimes it's a morning bite, sometimes it's an evening bite. You know, you might go somewhere one morning and it's just dead and not any good, but that evening you go back and there's action everywhere. So there's a few more pieces of the puzzle in the summertime. And unfortunately, it doesn't always make sense in that regard. But again, deeper water with a flat close by, and the flat can be 4 feet wide. It doesn't have to be a Port Mansfield big, you know, rolling grass beds forever. I do a lot of sight casting on a sandbar that's 3 feet wide, and it'll be covered with fish, you know, pretty consistently. So, you know, where can they go corner some stuff? but where can they go be comfortable at and recover whenever they need to?
Oh, 100%. I couldn't agree more. Now, we do have a lot of different skill levels of anglers that are probably listening to this podcast. And an area that you just described as an eddy, I'd like you to kind of break that down a little bit further for someone who may not know what an eddy is, because I do believe that is a fantastic spot to target in the summertime, you know, regardless of whether it's trout or redfish or flounder. You know, we are starting to get some flounder that are going to show up. That is a prime zone to target. Could you kind of break down what an eddy is for someone that may be listening that doesn't know?
Oh, because that's super easy to explain, right? All right. So say you're standing on a city street and there's a big building right beside you. You're on a corner. There's a big building and the wind is just whooping down that street from your back over the top of your head and towards you. If you step around the corner of that building, you can still feel a little bit of that wind coming around it, but it's not just blowing you down the road like it was right beside it. You know, that's essentially what an eddy is, where there's movement by it, but there's a point, there's a canal coming in, there's something where that current is going past it. And while there's still some movement around that point, it's not even close to as strong as that current going past it.
Yeah, so it's basically that kind of small zone behind a point, small zone behind some part of structure. It could even be an oyster bar. Eddies occur anywhere where there's a lot of current flow around a land-based location, or it could be just a raised sandbar where that current's whipping around somewhere and there's a calm spot. And a lot of times, like you said, those reds will be sitting in that calm spot, waiting for that bait to come around there. It's kind of like a little haven in some high current zones. And as we've talked about, reds are not going to sit in that current. They're going to find the calm spot where they can be lazy and they still have access to food. Sometimes they will shoot out in that current to grab some food. They'll go right back into that calm zone. Any breaks in islands, things like that, you'll find a lot of eddies behind some of these spoil islands. You know, if you're looking at the flats of the upper Laguna Madre, down further south in Brownsville areas where you've got these small patches of islands that line intercoastal channels, a lot of times you're going to have some really heavy current moving through those intercoastal channels. And the eddies are those spots that, you know, you can just find fish hanging out outside of the current. But again, they are still close. So just remember, high current areas in the summertime where there's good DO2, good bait flow, good positive things that redfish are looking for in terms of combating the summer heat and also having access to easy meals. They're going to be hanging out around those zones. So I think we've covered almost everything about summertime redfish that people would really need to know. But there's one subject that I wanted to save for last because it's probably the biggest question that we get. I'm obviously here in Corpus Christi. We do have some clearer water in the, you know, middle to southern parts of Texas. You're up in Matagorda, not Matagadora, as I butchered it in the prior video that I filmed with you. Matagorda, where there is some dirtier water. And as we're getting into the summertime, even here in Corpus, we are going to get some dirty water as well. And, you know, you're taking guides out in this dirty water every day. You're taking them out and you have to produce fish. Is there anything that you're doing differently? And I know you've fished in my area as well as further south here in Texas and even in Louisiana. So what are the things that you're going to be doing in dirty water versus, you know, the clear water when you're targeting these reds?
Well, and there's two types of dirty water. So we should cover that so we don't lead anybody astray here. There's the really muddy, really nasty stuff. And I'm going to avoid that if I can. But we also get the just like the heavy green, you know, the waters in the summertime, it's warm, is there's a big algae bloom in there, and that's, you know, that's that darker water that we really try to target over the really dirty stuff. But whether it's dirty or it's that dark water, what the difference I'm going to make is it's going to be tackle selection every time. If the water's, you know, really off color, then I'm going to throw most of the time a dark lure, a black lure with a chartreuse tail, or maybe something that contrasts a lot, like a white body with a red head. Vertical lines seem to contrast the best in dirty water versus a horizontal line. So that's whenever you get the, you know, there's the old school. The first lure ever was a red body with a white tail, you know, and that's still a very effective lure. But that vertical line seems to do really well there. I'll move with something with a bigger paddle tail, something that really displaces water. I've done a lot of fishing at night, and people, oh man, yeah, you're fishing on that full moon. Well, I'll fish under the new moon just as often and do just as well, where I cannot see my hand in front of my face. Fish, that their lateral lines and their senses, they do not have to see your lure. they don't have to see it. A shrimp can pop behind a redfish and he can turn around and nail it. And I've watched them do it. So, or something noisier. I'm going to go with maybe a she dog, a really noisy topwater, spinner baits, you know, that's moving a lot of water, making a lot of vibration. Popping cork and gulp is probably the number one thing that would work for you. The difference I'm going to do between cleaner water and dirtier water is I'm going to pop that cork, and you know, until my arm's falling off, but I'm going to pop it and I'm going to give it 6 or 8 seconds because I've just told that fish, hey, there's something feeding over here. And I want him to get there and have time to locate that lure underneath that popping cork. But other than that, my approach doesn't change a whole lot. It's just I am trying to hedge my bet in every way that fish knows that my lure is there. That's the biggest thing.
Absolutely. I 100% agree. You can't be using a lot. I will gravitate away from erratic style baits that don't produce vibration. So, for example, I just talked about jerk shads a little while ago. Great bait to use when you know where the fish are, you can see them and they're feeding in, you know, clearish water where they'd be able to see the action of that bait. You have to think about the bait that you're using. What is it doing to attract that strike? Is it a twitch that's going on that's going to trigger that reaction bite? Is it, you know, it's producing a presence in the water with rattles or a paddle tail, things like that. And I completely agree. In dirty water, it's very tough to beat some sort of vibration. We see a lot of the really big tournament anglers in the IFA using those redfish magic, spinner baits, things like that. A lot of times these are tournaments that are taking place in Louisiana where you've got really, really dirty water. Sometimes it's, as you said, that really muddy kind of brown chocolate color. And you have to have vibration and flash in that type of environment. But like, as you said, if it's, you know, a little bit greener, there's the algae bloom, but it's still slightly clean water. And this is, you know, I experienced this in the marshes of the Carolinas. I've seen it in Georgia as well. A lot of people believe there's only one type of dirty water and it's that brown water. That's not the case. Try to find those areas where it's, as Captain Caleb said, a little bit darker green. You'll find those closer to intercoastal channels where there is good current flow that can kind of clear out some of the sediment. But again, you're still with redfish, not looking for direct current flow. So find those coves that are slightly connected to that intercoastal channel where they're out of the current, but they have access to that bait that's getting pushed in or getting pulled out. And again, some slightly cleaner water. And you're not going to want to overdo it with the flash or the vibration when it does get to that kind of darkish green. It seems like you want to have a good balance of subtlety. And that's what I've seen just works really well is you want to have something that produces enough presence to let that fish, like you said, know that that bait is there and something's feeding there, but you don't want to overdo it. Cause I've seen fish scare off when there's, you know, too much of a presence in the water. And it's tough to do that at night. It seems like fish, you know, they don't really necessarily key in on something that's too much or too little. A lot of times I love fishing top waters. Like you said, that she dog, I've had some great success with redfish the past couple of nights fishing those she dogs on the edges of flats where, again, we've got drains, as we talked about earlier, great place to target right now. But yeah, I completely agree with you. In dirtier water, got to have presence, but balance it with subtlety based on the type of conditions that you're fishing under.
So for the folks that stayed around, how about we lay a little something extra on them here?
Oh, I think they absolutely deserve it, Caleb.
Because this is a staple, and it's the number one mistake that I see my customers make. And my customers, almost all of them are experienced fishermen. You know, I'm very lucky in that regard. And what it is, you know, when you go out and throw for a trout and you're drifting in 5 or 6 feet of water and you're twitch, 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 right? Or you go up on the flat and you throw up there and it's twitch, 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 right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's think about it this way. If you're a fish and you're laying there and you're hanging out and waiting for some food and this lure comes past you and it's just flying all over the place, right? That probably looks like a bait fish that knows you're there and it's going to be tough to come catch him, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what if you're just a redfish and you're laying there and here comes just a perfectly straight retrieve coming by your face of this bait fish that has no idea that you're there? Oh, right. The number one thing that and granted, there's times whenever twitches will get your reaction strike or whatnot. But whenever I'm sight casting, whenever I'm blind casting in the marsh, especially spring, summer, fall, I am. And this is targeting redfish. That's what we're talking about. I am almost always on a straight retrieve. I might reel it 10 or 15 feet and give it a little subtle twitch. But that straight retrieve catches more fish that time of year, for me anyway, than the twitch. So in the same time, if you're in dirty water and you're using that spinnerbait and you're a nice, solid, steady retrieve and that spinnerbait cutting straight through the water, well, that fish not only has an easier time feeling it and locating it, but it doesn't sound like something that knows that fish is there. So maybe if you're having trouble with that kind of stuff, maybe try just a slow, methodical retrieve. I mean, just normal speed. You don't have to drag it on bottom. But maybe make that bait look like an unsuspecting bait fish that has no idea there's another fish around him.
I could not agree with you more. It seems like the more that I've reduced the complexity of my retrieves, the more fish that I've caught. And I've just turned it into covering ground to try and find out where those fish are holding. But it's been surprising how just a straight, you know, constant four count retrieve, no extra twitches, nothing crazy. Maybe I'll mix in a twitch on the drops, you know, as I'm doing a constant retrieve, twitch, and then it drops down. But as you said, it needs to look like a unassuming bait fish. That's the perfect prey. That predator fish knows it doesn't need to expend a ton of energy. We got to remember, these redfish can't go around and reach into the fridge and get a snack whenever they want. They have to expend energy to get their food. And if they're expending their energy on a high risk scenario where that bait's going to get away, they just burned up a bunch of calories that they now have to make up in their next meal. So they're going to constantly look for the easy meal, the easy bait. So making that unassuming presentation of a slow, constant retrieve, especially when it gets warm, those fish, you know, they're a little bit more lethargic. You know, it seems like that pays off as well, but you know, reducing the complexity of the retrieve. A lot of times you aren't having to coax those bites out of the fish by adding in extra crazy twitches or anything like that. It seems like a straight retrieve just with, you know, a pause mixed in, you know, two or three times throughout the length of the retrieve. Again, allowing that bait to drop, get into that strike zone of those reds. Surprising how effective that is. I completely agree with you. And that is a big mistake I see a lot of people make. It's not as complex as a lot of people think it is. Simple straight retrieves can be absolutely killer, especially spring, summertime, and even going into the fall. I completely agree with you.
Yeah, so if one didn't work, and try the other. There's a time and place for both of them. But yeah, there's a reason the lion always eats the slow, unassuming, you know, buffalo or whatever in the back of the herd, right?
Oh yeah. Yeah, no, it's almost science, just because, you know, those fish, you know, they're not going to want to chase something down that's going to give them a tough time to feed. Again, they are not necessarily, you know, tracking their calorie counts on a Fitbit or anything like that, but they don't want to expend any energy that they don't have to, because they got to keep up those energy reserves. Again, cold-blooded animals cannot regulate their temperature. They can't control when their metabolism fires up, when it slows down. So especially when it warms up and that metabolism is going and they're burning calories all the time, they need to think about how they're expending their energy. So man, we have covered so much about redfish in this podcast. I want to thank you so much for coming on, Captain Caleb. It has been phenomenal having you share so much great information. I think there's a lot of things that, you know, a lot of people glaze over that we covered in this podcast in a little bit more depth. You know, that the elementary angler, as far as the veteran angler, is going to be able to kind of contemplate on a little bit more and add to their game plan and probably catch more redfish based off of some of the stuff that we've shared in this podcast. So I want to thank you again for coming on. I want to give you also a chance to shout out some of your channels and some of your avenues of education, because you put out some amazing content. I know we're going to have you on for some more tutorials here at Salt Strong, but I want to encourage people to check out some of your personal content as well, because it's absolutely phenomenal. That's why we have you on here today, because you're a great teacher, and I want people to go out and check your stuff out as well.
Oh, I appreciate it. So my YouTube is Captain Caleb TV, C-A-P-T Caleb TV. But if you type in Captain Caleb McCumber, it'll pull up. A lot of my stuff is studio based. I don't do as much of the GoPro on the chest out fishing. I do have some sight casting videos and whatnot, but it is more of a classroom learning experience. I'll throw in some from the water clips in with the videos. So I'm really into that. The Bite Me podcast, it's a podcast that comes out every Wednesday. And my YouTube, it usually comes out every Wednesday or Thursday. Sometimes I'm gone and can't keep up with it all the time. But, you know, those are the avenues I have. And then, you know, I come do stuff with Wyatt and Salt Strong and you know, the whole fam over there. So we try to help everybody out a little bit.
That's awesome. Yeah, no, we're excited to get you on here more. And it was really cool talking with you about, you know, how you prepare for tournaments and stuff, and then the ways that you find fish, and even just watching some of your YouTube tutorials. Use a lot of the same strategies that we talk about here at Salt Strong. And I do want to kind of encourage people to check out some of the things that we teach as well, because it seems like it's a lot of the same tactics that you use, using satellite maps, understanding the science of fish. That's why we were able to have such a great discussion today, because we think a lot alike. We use a lot of the same strategies to target these redfish and trout and flounder. And I want to encourage folks, if they are looking for kind of a comprehensive way to learn all these things in a really simple format, to join the Salt Strong Insider Club. We've got tons of mastery courses, especially one just on spots, you know, just how to learn how to scout satellite maps. We talked about, you know, eddies and little things like this. If you want to see actual examples of this on satellite maps and, you know, have it paired with on the water footage, we have on the water reports every week that show you guys live examples, what's working, how to scout it out on satellite maps, and just how to become a better angler just through learning the right science of these fish and how to use tactics to just maximize your success. So highly recommend you join us in the Salt Strong Insider Club, where we're going to be doing some more tutorials with Captain Caleb, how to fish certain baits. You know, I'm looking forward to getting a Corky tutorial 2.0 with you in, and we're going to have some really good stuff for you guys. So thank you guys so much again for watching, and I'm looking forward to seeing you on the next podcast. Thanks again for coming on, Captain Caleb.
Yes, sir. Hit the subscribe button, dang it.